And the third quarter earnings of Nigeria's commercial banks released in the last 2 weeks have been bittersweet. However, most of the numbers were in line with analysts' expectations. Now, although some financial experts say the days of robust profit may be fast fading for these banks, others believe that the recent regulatory changes and the growth in the broader economy may present even better opportunities for the lenders. Now, can we bank on that? Ike Chioke, Managing Director of Afrinvest, is here with me in the studio to put all of that into perspective for us. Thank you so much for taking the time out to join us. Now, let's take a look. Let's take a look at the numbers. Of course, they came out largely mixed, but you already saw that.
Yeah,
coming, looking at your report for on the banking sector, Nigeria's banking sector in 2013, you highlighted a number of factors that you said could potentially put pressure on the earnings of these banks.
Yes, you recall earlier this year, around April, the CBN came out with a raft of new measures on how to streamline the cost to bank customers and effectively stripping most of the fee earning opportunities for Nigerian banks. We've seen COT now being guided downwards from 5 per mil to 3 per mil in 2013, and it's going to go down to 2 per mil in 2014, 1 per mil in 2015, and then will disappear altogether from 2016 onwards. You've seen also the disappearance of the 100 naira charge each time you go to an ATM that's not your bank's to take money out. And also there was a hidden 100 naira per month ATM maintenance charge that banks used to levy. That's also gone. And there's also been increase in what rates banks can pay to savings accounts. So whereas some savings accounts were earning as little as 1.5%, I think the minimum now is about 3%. So where you see an industry where the revenue opportunities are being taken away and then the cost opportunities are gradually inching upwards. Hence, banks will therefore need to be more adept in thinking of new ways to make money and remain profitable given this, the increased size and scale of the operations.
Now look at, and I'm sure you've seen most of the number, or if not all of them, that have come out so far, with the exception of First Bank, either from the first tier or the second tier. Now, were there any numbers that you found to be exceptionally disappointing or lower than expected?
No, not really. We did see, reasonable growth at the top line, sort of in the early double digit stages. Only one bank, I think Access, was slightly down on the top line. But as expected, when it comes to the PBT, most of them were actually down relative to the same period last year, and could be as little as 9%, some as high as 36% overall. So you can see clearly that the effects of the CBN new guidance on costs and fee income is already taking effect. And this will probably worsen as people begin to take provisions that have happened as a result of the demise of the
How soon will the banks, how soon will that wear off the banks, if at all it will? Because I do know that many banks, obviously, they have to, going into the new year, they have to begin to, they have to go back to the drawing board, really re-strategize, look at the competition space, and think about how they're going to grow their bottom line sustainably over, sustainably going forward. But for you, what's the first thing you expect them to begin to do right now?
I think retail banking and SME banking is going to be the new frontier. Presently, many banks have had a strategy of mobilizing deposits from the mass affluent and from corporates and the government, and then lending to multinationals, and then using the fee income, COT, fees and commissions to boost their earnings. And then, of course, they can always play in the treasury markets and the bond market. But as the CBN is guiding all those fee opportunities down, the only avenue left is really to try and lend to the real sector, lend to retail, where there's still decent margin to be earned from making credit available to that sector. So we see banks like GTB, for instance, Stanbic IBTC, making new inroads into the retail and
But with that comes
SMEs.
Risk. What's the risk level?
Well, the risk level is something that if you actually manage it efficiently, of course, if you think of lending 5 billion naira to a single corporate versus lending 5 billion naira to 1,000 individuals, you may have maybe 100 people default out of 1,000, but it's still a manageable.
Because the CBN comes to my mind now, and I know that the CBN, the Central Bank of Nigeria, is fiercely protective of these banks. And when issues of risk come out and defaulting, non-performing loans, we see the regulator immediately step in.
That's true, but remember, there's also other things that are coming into place in the industry today. There's the credit bureau standards. There's also all the other systems that link your account to your phone number. So banks have multiple ways of checking that indeed they're lending to a real person, and this person does have a potential to pay back, and also look at what kind of collateral they're holding back. But I think SME, lending and retail lending will be one of the new areas that banks will begin to exploit as they see opportunities dry up in the more traditional space.
But would you say them also leaning towards trying to, in terms of cost basis, managing costs going forward into the new year?
Yes, clearly a lot of people are doing that, but technology is also becoming a big competitive advantage. If you think of some of the banks that have deployed online banking efficiently, increasingly some can even record as much as 20% of their traffic happening online, where there is no branch network and there's no generator running to keep it active. So long as your services are up and available 24/7, then your customers can go online and do a lot of transactions. GT Bank apparently is a leader in that space as well, but you can see others also building up that capacity. So there are many avenues to lower the cost, not just being efficient in trying to manage the actual costs, but there are other ways to grow your income and grow your base of customers with actually having that incremental branch network rollout costs, as it were.
Many times when we talk about banks growing their top line, growing their bottom line, looking at the competition space, you know, I'm just thinking maybe we need to go back to the drawing board. Why are those banks there in the first place? Their major priority, I guess, you know, as banks is to lend to the real economy. They're there to boost, you know, the economy. So going forward, are we going to see a bigger participation? Are they going to be looking more to perhaps key sectors that we've seen with sustainable growth, perhaps telecoms, agriculture, and maybe one or two other new sectors of the economy?
Yes, you already have begun to see that there's going to be increasing specializations. There are some banks that are better known to be great in oil and gas than others. And some people have taken the agricultural transformation agenda of the government very seriously and are building structures around lending to that industry. As the power industry has come out, you've seen nearly $3 billion of lending to that sector to help the new investors who have acquired the various PHN assets. So you find people who are going to have specializations in generating companies, in distribution companies, as well as in the power services area. These are all new opportunities across the whole value chain. These are new areas that banks can hopefully move into and earn some premium income before everybody arrives. You also have seen that the CBN has, you know, focused on also other kinds of banking. The mortgage banking industry might get a boost with the establishment of the Mortgage Refinancing Commission, which could provide a new kind of funding line for mortgage banks, PMIs, to be able to lend people at affordable interest rates to buy their first homes. That would be something to watch out for in this space within the next 12 months. Similarly, you've seen the demise of the discount house and the emergence of the merchant banking space. Consolidated discount house has imploded, and CBN is painstakingly trying to pay off all the non-bank depositors. So clearly, the banking industry might have to take some write-downs on whatever exposure they had with CDL and also Express Discount House. But the converse is that other discount houses, ADH and Kakawa, are now pushed against the wall where they have been forced, as it were, to convert into merchant banks to join the ranks of Rand Merchant Bank, which is already established, and FSDH. Other people are also looking to enter the merchant banking space, including Afrinvest, for instance. So that would be an interesting new industry that would emerge.
So I guess overall, I mean, the banks, there's really nothing for us to worry about in terms of, you know, this growth, them keeping, strengthening their brands going forward and looking at places where they know that they can, you know, actually find a profit, as it were.
I think the banks will struggle to make the kind of numbers you saw last year. I think if anybody gets $100 billion PBT, they've done a terrific job. And you have to look carefully to make sure they are not one-off income opportunities, and these are ongoing real revenue from the normal cost of
business. I'm sure the central bank will be there to ensure that happens. So thank you so much. We're going to have to
thank you, Esther. Thank you.